Double fulfillment. Number one, there was a near future. Number two, there was a far future. As Daniel was looking at this, was looking at that in future. It's like you have two mountains before you. There's one standing near, there's another one standing afar off. And when you look at those two mountains from afar, it appears that they are top, their peaks, they almost merge together. And yet there is a gulf, a wide space between those two mountains. The first mountain will be the near future, and the second mountain will be the far future. And so as we read this, it has a kind of double interpretation and double application. Number one, it was applicable to Antiochus Epiphanes, and he was the fulfillment in the near future. A few years, a few hundreds of years after Daniel prophesied, this vile person Antiochus appeared. And then he did many of these things that Daniel had prophesied. But it's a far, far future. At the time of the Antichrist, when the Antichrist will come, and it will be the final future fulfillment of this that we're reading. Let's go on now from verse 22. And with the arms of a flood shall they be overflown from before him, and shall be broken. Ye also, the prince of the covenant, and after the league made with him, he shall walk deceitfully. He'll come in a deceitful way with flatteries, and then when he comes like that, he will try to turn the minds of the people, and he'll say, the man is so peaceful, the man is so gentle. Could this be the prince of peace we're waiting for? Could this be the person that will bring peace between Israel and the Middle East? Could this be the person, this great, great politician? Because his politics, he'll start with the politics of peace. He'll say, why are we fighting one another? We're not going to fight anymore. And then he'll appeal to Israelites, appeal to the Arab nations, appeal to Europe, appeal to all the rest of the world, Africa, Asia, America, everywhere. Let's all come together. And when he does that, the people will think, this is a wonderful person, this is a great personality. He wants us to put down our swords, and then all the people agree with him. Verse 23, after the league made with him, he shall work this deceitfully, for he shall come up and he shall become strong with a small people. In verse 24, he shall enter peaceably even upon the fasted places of the province, and he shall do that which his fathers have not done, nor his father's fathers. That is his fathers that came before him, all these other politicians, all these other kings, all these other presidents, trying to bring the nations together. And we have the United Nations already now, and they have been trying for how many years now, and they have not been able to bring peace everywhere in the world. But this other one will come, and for a short period, what the UN was not able to do, and what all the other people were not able to do, they just bring them together. And the people will say, this is fantastic, this is glorious, we've never seen anything like this before. I pray you'll not be here at that time. For those people, they'll wait and see. They'll just find that everything will turn around very suddenly. Verse 24, and he shall do that which his father's fathers have not done. And then it says, and he shall scatter among them the prey and spoil and riches, yea, and he shall forecast his devices against the strongholds, and even for a time. Verse 25, and he shall stir up his power and his courage, and his courage against the king of the south with a great army, and the king of the south shall be stirred up to battle with a very great and mighty army. But he shall be great and mighty, but he shall forecast the devices against him. Yea, they that feed of the portion of his meat, that is those who are, he invited them, I'll feed you, I'll take care of you. And there'll be some plans that you'll think is just philanthropic, and it's so generous, and it's helping all these other people. And he's saying that, you know, when he brings all those things, you know, he's giving money here, he's giving donation there, and he's giving, he has a food distribution plan, and he's giving food to these other people and to all these ones, people will say, well, we have arrived. What else are we looking for? And even if that Christ will come, if this one is not the Christ, if that Christ will come, will he be able to do more than this one is doing? But he'll do that to draw them near, so that he can destroy them, so that he'll be able to fight against them with great might and great power. That's why it says, they that feed upon of the portion of his meat shall destroy him, and his army shall overflow, and many shall fall down slain, and both these kings' hearts shall be to do mischief, and they shall speak lies at one table. They'll be deceiving and deceiving one another. They'll be speaking lies to one another at the same table. That is, they'll have conference together. They'll say, let's make this firm, and let us set up a treaty, and let us write a communique, and let us do something so that this agreement we're having now, it will never change. And then they'll be telling lies to one another, but it shall not prosper, for yet the end shall be at the time appointed. Then shall he return into his land with great riches, and his heart shall be against the holy covenant, and he shall do exploits and return to his own land. At the time appointed he shall return and come toward the south, but it shall not be as the former or as the latter. We're talking about this personality yet to come. I just told you that this personality, he had a fulfillment in Antiochus Epiphanes, but he's going to have a final future fulfillment in the Antichrist. But as we study this, I don't want you to throw everything just into the future. I don't want you to throw everything all to the Antichrist and Antiochus Epiphany. Do you know that sometimes it can happen like that too around us? In fact, let me show you the story of David. We're looking at 2 Samuel chapter 15. In 2 Samuel chapter 15, you're going to see something like this. This is like a shadow. This is like something that happened even before the time of this prophecy that is very, very similar to what is going to happen, which is teaching us that we ourselves should be on our guard, that there may be people that will come like this. They come with flattery, and they come with deceptive politics, and it appears these are the final bust up, and this is what I'm going to settle on, because you know this man is so great, and this individual is so wonderful, and is going to provide this and this and that. If they don't have Christ, don't trust them. If they're not righteous, you can't trust them. If they don't believe the doctrines of the Bible, you cannot trust them. And if they are not standing for righteousness, righteous and faithful to the Lord and faithful to the body of Christ, you cannot trust people like that. 2 Samuel, we're looking at chapter 15 verse 6. In 2 Samuel chapter 15, I'm reading there from verse 6. Look at what it says. It tells us, and on this manner did Absalom to all Israel that came to the king for judgment. So Absalom stole the hearts of the men of Israel by flattery, by deception, by peaceful kind of approach, the way he approached all those Israelites that came to the king. And have you noticed how their names start? Absalom, Antiochus, Antichrist, they all start with that A. And when you see people like that, and if you're not prayerful, and if you're not getting any message from the Lord, and you just fall for that for the rest of your life, and then you get into deception, I pray God will preserve your life in Jesus' name. And it came to pass after 40 years that Absalom said unto the king, I pray thee, let me go and pay my vow, which I have vowed unto the Lord in Hebron. He even became religious, and he said, I have a vow to pay, and I want to go and pay that vow. And was telling David to give him chance to go and do that. For thy servant vowed a vow while I abode at Geshur in Syria, saying, if the Lord shall bring me again indeed to Jerusalem, then I will serve the Lord. And the king said unto him, what? Go in peace. What else can you tell this man that looks so gentle and so meek and so peaceful, and is saying, I had a vow, I'm going to worship the Lord. My daddy, David, you are worshiping the Lord. I've made a vow to you. I'm going to worship the Lord like you. Think about that kind of deception. And he arose and went to Hebron. But Absalom sent spies throughout all the tribes of Israel, saying, as soon as he hear the sound of the trumpet, then he shall say, Absalom reigns in Hebron. And with Absalom went how many? 200 men out of Jerusalem that were called, and they went how? In their simplicity, and they knew not anything. That's the deception. And when the Antichrist will call, that's exactly what will be repeated again. They will just follow that Antichrist, not knowing anything, not knowing the deception and the flattery, and not knowing that all this is to destroy them. But you know what happened at the time of Absalom? Many people lost their lives because they went in their simplicity and they fell for that deception. They lost their lives. That's the reason why the Lord is warning us and teaching us all this. And you don't just throw everything to the time of Daniel and to the time of Antiochus Epiphanes. You're not throwing everything we're studying to the time of the Antichrist to come. You're making some application of this to your life today. That if you fall for a deceptive person, if you fall for a person that looks, appears to be peaceful, but yet is a bear, is a devil at heart, that you're going to destroy your life and you're going to destroy many, many people. Let's look at 2 Samuel chapter 18. I'm reading from verse 6. 2 Samuel chapter 18, verse 6. So the people went out into the field against Israel, and the battle was in the wood of Ephraim, where the people of Israel were slain before the servants of David. And there was what? A great slaughter that day of 20,000 men, for the battle was there scattered over the face of all the country. And the wood devoured more people that day than the sword devoured. And that's why we're studying all this, that, well, it happened already in time of Antiochus Epiphany, because Antiochus Epiphany already lived some 160 years before Christ. And then the Antichrist is still coming, but even now the false prophets and the false people, they're still acting like that coming Antichrist. And that's what the Lord is telling us, that that day is still coming when people are going to be acting like this. And you want to be very prayerful, very vigilant, and depending upon the Spirit of God, so they will not deceive you. You will not be deceived in Jesus' name. We're looking at Psalm 55, verse 21. Psalm 55, verse 21. The words of his mouth were smoother than butter, but war was in his heart. That's talking about it. We can apply that to Absalom. We can apply that to Antiochus Epiphany. We can apply that to the Antichrist. And we can apply that to the people that have the spirit of the Antichrist. The words of his mouth, they were smoother than honey, than butter, but war was in his heart. His words were softer than oil, yet were they drawn swords. And when that Antichrist will eventually come, see what the Bible says in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, we're reading from verse 1. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, we're reading from verse 1. But of the time and the seasons, brethren, ye have no need that I write unto you, for yourselves know perfectly that the day of the Lord so cometh as a thief in the night. For when they shall say peace and safety, when that vile personality will arise, when that terrible king shall arrive, when that Antichrist will eventually come, and he brings the peace and the flattery and the deception, and he's looking so gentle and sheepish like a lamb, and yet he's a lion, a devouring lion, they will think there is peace and safety. Then sudden destruction cometh upon them as travail upon a woman with child, and they shall not escape. Look at 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, reading from verse 9, talking about the Antichrist, even him whose coming is after the working of Satan, with all power and signs and lying wonders. People will not look at that word lying, lying wonders. You know what they will look at? All they will see is, they will see power, they will see signs, they will see wonders. All they will see is, they will see miracle. And because that's what they're looking for, miracle of provision, miracle of abundant supply, miracle of peaceful coexistence, miracle of war, no war at this particular time. That's at the beginning of the Great Tribulation. And they will say, this is wonderful, signs and wonders and power, but the lying wonders. Then it says in verse 10, and with all deceivableness of unrighteousness in them that perish, because they received not the love of the truth, that they might be saved. You know what can preserve us from such a people that deceive? When we have the love of the truth. When we say, Lord, the number one sin in my life, the number one sin in my desire, the number one sin in my aspiration, the number one sin in my goal, my dream, in the number one sin in my accomplishment, achievement, will be the love for the truth. You know, if you're like that, and you exalt truth above any other need in your life, above the needs of your flesh, you exalt truth above pleasure, you exalt truth above riches, you exalt truth above prosperity, and you exalt truth above just superficial peace. You say, well, I want to be peaceful, but truth is above that. I want to have pleasure and satisfaction, but truth is above that. I want to have riches if riches are available, but truth is above that. I want to have a good relationship, interaction with people, but truth is above that. That is the only thing that can save us and preserve us. But if you put the truth to the background and say, well, doctrine divides, doctrine is going to bring problem, and so let's forget all about doctrine now, let's forget about the truth now, and let's just have prosperity, and let us have partnership, and let us have coexistence together, and let us have success, and let us have climbing the mountain, let us be the head, let's forget about doctrine, let's forget about the truth, you're going to be deceived. But when you put the truth in the front and say, my priority is the truth. If somebody loves the truth and he wants the truth, yes, I'm for him and he is for me and we are together. But once the truth is not there, then we say, no, we cannot go along together. Look at that again in verse 10. And with all deceivableness of unrighteousness in them that perish, because they receive not the love of the truth, that they might be saved. And for this cause God shall send them strong delusion. I pray you will not have delusion, so that they should believe a lie. You will not believe a lie. I said you will not believe a lie. You know, if you love the truth, the spirit of truth will always abide with you. And anytime error is coming, anytime deception is coming, the spirit of truth will set the alarm in your heart and say, no, no, that there's error there. There is error that is hidden behind that flattery. Underneath that kind of deceptive policy, there is error there. The spirit of truth will alert you, and you're not going to error in Jesus' name. And it says that they all might be damned, believe not the truth, but have pleasure in unrighteousness. But all this that was studying, they're still in the future, in their final future fulfillment. Look at Habakkuk chapter 2. Habakkuk chapter 2, and we're reading there from verse 3. The Lord is telling us there's an appointed time when this will still be fulfilled in the future. Habakkuk chapter 2, verse 3. For the vision is yet for an appointed time, but at the end it shall speak and not lie. Though it tarry, wait for it, because it will surely come and will not tarry. As we look at this picture of the Antichrist to come, already we have seen that Antiochus was like a preview of this Antichrist to come. And what do we see about him from what we have read? Summarizing everything, a vile person, to whom they shall not give the honor of the kingdom, but he'll rise to power and will obtain that kingdom by flatteries. He raised up a mighty army described as the arms of a flood. And then we're told the character of Antiochus is fully described by Daniel, the prophet. Already that has gone into history. And those of us who have read history, we have known that that's exactly what happened at the time of the Maccabees. Now it says he shall be a vile person, verse 21. And he shall come peaceably, still verse 21. And obtain the kingdom by flatteries, verse 21. And he shall walk deceitfully, that's verse 23. He shall enter peaceably, and he shall do that which his fathers have not done We've read that in verse 24. He shall do mischief and speak lies. Verse 27. He'll be deceiving and he'll be deceived. They'll be speaking lies at the same table. 2 Timothy chapter 3 verse 13. And his heart shall be against the holy covenant. Verse 28. Under the guise of friendship. Under the guise of fellowship. Under the guise of being a peaceful person. Antiochus plundered the riches of the